And of course, there was all the rumors. There was all the rumors that it's very difficult and people fail and drop out. So my mom was very much against it. She's like, don't do it, Michael. Don't do it. You know, like, enjoy your life. Enjoy your life. Do, like, you know, accounting where, yes, you work hard, but you still got time to socialize and stuff like that.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to my channel. For those who are new, my name is V. I am a qualified actuary and currently working and living in Canada. My channel mission is to help you study smarter, work better, and live happier. This is another episode of the Careers in Math series, where I will feature various professionals related to actuarial science, data science, and finance, accounting, technology, and more. So I'm hoping that this video will help you in deciding what to study or what career path to pursue. I am very excited to have Michael from MJ The Fellow Actuary channel. He is a fully qualified actuary from South Africa. Today, he will share with us his actuarial journey, as well as a lot of great insights and tips to become an actuary of the future. Hi, Michael. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Okay, perfect, Josh. So my name is Michael Jordan, which of course gets a lot of the basketball jokes. But Josh, born here in South Africa, grew up in a Christian household, and I've always been a little bit, curious, always wanted to ask questions and figure out how the world works. Took an early liking to finance. I think that's because my older brother's an accountant. Finance was something that we could discuss with each other. And that's what kind of when I heard about actuarial science, because I didn't really know much about it. I just heard it had something to do with finance, and it was a big challenge. And I was like, let me give this a go.
Thanks, Michael. So once you heard about it, what made you decide to pursue this profession? Because as we know it, the path to become an actuary can be very long and challenging.
Yeah, I mean, like I say, I didn't know much about it. I think going through my last year of school, the focus was always going to be accounting. That's what my brother had done. My brother was doing quite well at it. Like I said, I enjoyed the stock market, enjoyed reading books on Warren Buffett and the investment side of things. So when I heard there was this thing called actuarial science, and it had something to do with money, I was interested. I kind of liked the fact that it was a mystery. That I think that is also something that drew me to it, was the fact that I didn't know what I was getting into. And that was kind of attractive. You know, it was kind of like, this is going to be an adventure. I had done very well at school. I was the top student in quite a lot of the subjects. So what eventually happened was one of my dad's friends, his brother-in-law was an actuary. And he said, "Flip, you know, these guys make a lot of money. They're good at maths. Your son's good at maths. Why doesn't he give it a go?" And that's kind of like when I got introduced to it. And of course, there was all the rumors. There was all the rumors that it's very difficult and people fail and drop out. So my mom was very much against it. She's like, don't do it, Michael. Don't do it. You know, like, enjoy your life. Enjoy your life. Do, like, you know, accounting where, yes, you work hard, but you still got time to socialize and stuff like that. But like I say, I was pulled in by the challenge. Maybe I was feeling a little bit too arrogant after doing well at school. How ignorant I was of actuarial science was, I thought we were going to have to do physics and chemistry because science was in the word. Like, so I wasn't really looking forward to it. I mean, science wasn't my strongest. I mean, I still got the top mark for science in my school, but it was one that I really had to push at and actually went for extra lessons for, which I know sounds crazy. Like, if you're top of the class, why are you going for extra lessons? But that was kind of my mindset, was I wanted to get top mark in every subject. Science was the hardest one to top. And that's, I wasn't looking forward to the physics and the chemistry. And so I was very, very happy to see when I got my first year subjects, that's, you know, chemistry, physics was not part of it. I was like, yes, I can do this. I can do this. Of course, then I came across statistics, and that's, that kind of cut me down at the knees, because statistics at school versus statistics at university are two completely different animals. And that was probably where there was a big struggle. And then, of course, the actuarial notation also really confused me in first year. Like, I was like, what's going on?
Can you tell us more about your channel and what you are currently working on?
So, like I said, the channel, it's quite exciting. We're coming close to hitting 25,000 subscribers, which is, I don't know, it's a big number. Like, I know as far as YouTube subscribers go, you know, we so used to guys like PewDiePie and these others that are like the hundreds of millions, and, you know, it's scary numbers out there. But if you think 25,000, it's a lot of people. So it's a little bit scary that so many people have. I mean, no, I was looking at the statistics the other day. I think in total across the channel, there's been more than 2 million views. So it is scary that there has been that wide impact on such a niche subject. But yeah, like I was saying earlier, the channel kind of started, like I said, it wasn't intentional to start out a YouTube channel. It was to make these study notes for myself, videos so that I could learn what I was eating. And that kind of developed into the channel that we have today. As well as also said, it got a little bit neglected this year because I was making videos for government, and it's become very much part of my job now is educating. So I'm making videos for government and for other clients. So the YouTube channel has taken a little bit of a back foot, but I'm hoping to bring it back with quite a fun series on the actuarial history, where we'll look at, you know, who was the first actuary, then who gave actuaries their name, and when did the profession start, and stories about the first insurance companies and mistakes that they made. And then to make it a little bit more fun, because my channel also has a little bit of crypto. I mean, currently with Bitcoin going through the roof, the most watched videos on my actuarial science channel are like the first like 5 or 6 videos that I made on Bitcoin. Those are getting the most views. So I do know that I think a lot of my subscribers are aware of crypto. So I've kind of blended the two together, actuarial science history and cryptocurrency. And what we're doing is we've made a treasure hunt. So when you learn about these people who started actuarial science, you can go and buy their collector card, you know, like we play Pokemon cards and those kind of things, the trading cards. So you can buy these cards, but what's cool about it being on the blockchain is each of these cards contain a secret, and you can only look at the secret if you are in possession of the card. And then what the secret is, it's a riddle. And if you solve the riddle, you get a word. And if you get 12 correct words and you figure out the order, which you need a little bit of a mathematical pattern for, then this will allow you to unlock a crypto wallet that contains 10 Ethereum, which I've made by selling art on the blockchain a little bit earlier. But now 10 Ethereum with this price jump, it's become quite a big little prize now. Like I think when I made it, it was like $4,000, and now it's like $6,500. So it's a good price. There's currently 5 cards out at the moment. In total, there'll only be 100 different cards. So like I say, you've got to figure out the mathematical puzzle on which of those 100, out of the 100, which 12 you need. But the lovely thing is you can buy a card, look at the secret, and then resell it and kind of have a little bit of a trading market there. So I'm hoping that will also give me a monetary incentive to keep making these videos for the YouTube channel. It's kind of like I'm teaching history, and the idea is that this then creates hype around the crypto treasure hunt, and vice versa, because YouTube ad revenue is, like I say, I've been making these crypto art pieces. I'll sell a crypto art piece that maybe takes me 30 minutes to make, and it'll sell for double the amount of money that my entire YouTube channel makes in a month. So you can see I think people come onto YouTube, they're like, we're going to be rich, we're going to make so much money, and it's no. But the thing is, I should maybe qualify that statement. Direct, like ad revenue has been very, very low, but it's been wonderful for my career in the sense that I have got a lot of clients through the YouTube channel, because, well, you can imagine if somebody needs someone to build a capital model, they'll Google it. And if there's a YouTube channel of a guy explaining how to build a capital model, they're like, well, why don't we ask this guy to build our capital model then for us? So YouTube has been very beneficial in that sense. I mean, I have been fortunate enough to not do a corporate job or an office environment since 2016, because I have been able to generate enough clients from the channel. So I shouldn't knock it too much by saying the ad revenue hasn't been that high. The additional benefits that have come across with it have really been great. So if you are out there and you do want to make a YouTube channel, it's kind of like a long-term investment, which is very actuarial. Just think about us actuaries. Mm-hmm. We like to think about the long-term. So not a lot of short-term gain, but the long-term potential is quite good. So yeah, hopefully that does motivate anybody out there. If they have a channel and they're like, I'm making $5 ad revenue a month, this is horrible, you know, stick in there and you can probably make a bit more, not only the ad revenue, but like I say, in getting clients and other gigs.
Yeah, I agree. I think YouTube work this way because it's actually help you to build a brand. And in this, when people want to look for actual expertise, they can come to you for that.
It's a little bit of a double-edged sword, because like you said, you spot on, it's your brand. So of course you've got to be very careful what you say on your YouTube channels. And especially my YouTube channel, where, you know, it's been going since 2013, which means it's got videos of me 7 years younger, probably not saying the smartest things on various topics. So, and I mean, how YouTube works, those videos have got the most views. So those normally come up, you know, when people first type in MJ Actuary, that comes up first. And I cringe a little bit. Like I got one video where it's the myths of the actuarial exams. And I say something stupid, like if you get 100% for the exams, you know, the Illuminati contact you. And you know, I've had a client ask me about that, and I was just so embarrassing. I'd be like, no, you know, that was me back in the day. You know, that was just for fun. They're like, oh, okay, so you're not part of the Illuminati. I'm like, no, I'm not. So yeah, there's, like I said, it is a little bit of a double-edged sword. So you do have to be mindful of what you say. But I've always tried to take the view, and I think that's why I don't take down those old videos, is I want to, whatever I say, I want to have enough confidence that I'm happy for this to be up forever. So of course, watch what I say, but if I do say something, stick with it, you know, back yourself, right? Because otherwise you'd be constantly auditing yourself, and that can, yeah, that can be a nightmare. So, and also then your channel hardly have, yeah, my channel would hardly have any videos there. So yeah, it's definitely something that you got to be cautious about. I mean, yeah, I think a lot of people have destroyed their personal brands with social media. I mean, an example that comes to mind straight away is this new Formula One driver for next year. He's been posting horrible things on social media, and the internet has turned against him. So if you are going to become big on social media, yeah, make sure that you, or realize that you're playing with fire. You know, can fire is great for cooking and all these kind of things, but it can also burn down your entire house. So yeah, treat it cautiously.
Can you comment on the actual profession state in South Africa? So how can one become fully qualified in the country?
I mean, South Africa, the fact that we were a British colony means that we're very similar to the British actuarial system, which I think, and I know you're from Canada and, you know, close to America, I think the British is the best system, just in the sense that, you know, it was the British people who kind of invented actuarial science. Edmund Halley was British, William Morgan was British. Yes, they did have the American friends, like I said, Benjamin Franklin and all of those guys in the Buddha that I discussed. So America is closely linked to actuarial science, but the British kind of, you know, took it seriously. They created an amazing profession, and the South African society is very similar. I mean, our exams, some even say that there's rumors that go around that our exams are even a little bit harder than the British exams, because we're trying to prove ourselves, you know, because we're a much smaller country. Our exams are a lot harder. And I must say, like, because we write half of the IFOA exams and we write half of the ASA exams. ASA is South Africa, IFOA the UK exams. And I must say, look, and I'm probably terribly biased, but it does seem that those rumors are true, that the South African exams are a little bit harder than the UK exams, because we're trying to prove ourselves. I mean, and what we're trying to prove ourselves is, yes, if you've got the actuarial profession in South Africa, you can go to the UK and you can work as an actuary there. You can't go to America and work as an actuary. I think the SOA don't recognize the South African profession. And I know that's something, it might have changed. But while I was studying, that was definitely a big topic of discussion. So South Africans, we pride ourselves in our difficult exams. But as far as the profession goes, I mean, some of the biggest companies on our stock exchange, like Sanlam and Old Mutual, are actuarial companies. So actuaries are very much sought after in South Africa. There's a lot of respect for the job. A lot of people, they might not know exactly what we do, but, you know, if you tell someone, hey, I'm an actuary, majority of them have heard of it. They're like, oh, okay, you're smart and maths. And they don't really know more of it than that, but, you know, at least it does have a bit of that reputation. So yeah, it is a thriving thing. I think a lot of European countries and Asian countries do look for South African actuaries. I mean, it's quite common for a South African actuary to go to, say, Singapore or Hong Kong and work there. Also, we sometimes get lots of adverts from the Australians saying, hey, come work in Australia. So yeah, I think the actuarial profession here in South Africa is thriving. And I must say, one other cool thing about South African actuaries is the current, or going to be the next, president of the International Actuarial Association is my old lecturer from WITS. She was first the president of the ASA Society, and now she's the president of the IAA. So the fact that the person who's heading up the International Actuarial Association is South African can kind of give you a little bit of an idea of how good the quality is here. But as to get it, kind of need a degree, a bachelor's degree with at least 2 years of mathematics in order to qualify as a student member. Also, to get accepted as a student member, you need two fellows to sign off that you're a decent person, that, you know, you have an ethical standing so that you can get in. Once you're in, you then have a lot of exams to write. What's nice about South Africa is we do have university programs that are geared towards actuarial science that do allow you to get exempt from writing the exams. So you can get maybe 6 or 7 exemptions at university if you work hard, if you get like a very high mark. Otherwise, you've got to write, I'm trying to think if I can I list all the exams? There's statistics, there is business accounting, there's business economics, then there's financial maths, there's financial engineering, Then there's life contingencies. That's one thing that we're a little bit different to the UK. We put financial maths and life contingencies as separate subjects. They kind of combine those two as one. And then we've got survival models and, loss models and survival analysis. Oh, no, sorry. I'm getting confused because we had CT6 and CT4 that combined. So the exams did change in 2018. So it's now loss reserving and financial engineering. And then there's survival models and risk analysis. Those are the two kind of like new subjects. Then once you have done all of those are kind of like your foundational technical subjects. You then write more of the application exams. There's one on model documentation, one on communication. And then there's the horrible one or the big giant one called actuarial risk management, which is a lot of theory. When I mean a lot of theory, it's a lot. Like it's life insurance, general insurance, health insurance, banking, pension funds. And you've got to expect it to know all of it. Fortunately, once you've done that exam, you've kind of, you're on the final straight because then you choose two subjects to specialize in. I chose finance and risk. Most people choose life insurance, but there's also health, general, pension. And South Africans have pioneered the banking exam, which is also quite cool. It's going international. And then of those two that you specialize in, you choose one to do your fellowship in. And so because I had finance and risk, I could either do my fellowship in banking or in finance, and I chose finance. So and then of course there's all these other small multiple choice questions that you have to do on law and professionalism and work-based skills. And so it's kind of, I remember like I finished all the exams and it took me another year to get the designation of fellow because there was a lot of admin and you had to write essays. And so, yeah, it's a long journey. So hopefully that gives a very, very quick summary of what it's all about. And then of course it doesn't end because you've got continual professional development, the CPD points that you need to, keep showing the profession that you're worthy of an actuary, because they don't want these old expired people to have the branding and then, not being keeping up with the times. So CPD is also very important to make sure that the mind stays fit and that the knowledge is constantly updated. So yeah, that's kind of like actuarial science in South Africa in a nutshell.
Yeah. The Society of Actuary actually also introduced a couple more exam recently that revolve in statistical modeling and predictive analytics. So really to keep up with the trends of what we see in data science recently.
Yeah, I saw in the exams now, they've added in a data science section and there's more exams. Oh, they now have an R component with the exams and stuff like that. And we were lucky because at WITS, they just taught us R kind of like anyway. Whereas I see some of the students now are maybe don't go to WITS, which is my university, they sometimes struggle a little bit with, what is this R programming and stuff like that. So, but fortunately, I have made I made a free course on Udemy on getting started with R, just so that people can get used to what all these different panels do and how to do very basic things so that they're comfortable with it. Because otherwise it can be quite intimidating the first time you want to program. You feel like you're in the matrix, you're like typing just letters on a screen and hoping something will happen. So yeah, I have made, it's a very short course. I think it's like 8 videos, I think, in total, and it's only 54 minutes and kind of covers the basics. And then that was one of the videos that was sponsored by the Actuarial Society. So the idea is that if enough people watch it and like it, the Actuarial Society might be saying, okay, cool, make more advanced videos, where you delve into, say, time series and data science and all those kind of good things. So, yeah, hopefully more videos will be on the way on that front.
That is very great to hear. So on this topic, what knowledge or skill set do you believe an actuary need to continue to develop to become future-proof?
There's two skills that come to mind straight away. The one you could almost refer to as a hard skill and the other as a soft skill. So let's maybe start with the hard skill. The hard skill is programming. That's a skill where you can go online, you can watch a bunch of videos, you can take a course and you can learn how to develop learn a programming language and write some code, develop some applications. And I think that's important because as an actuary, you've got all this knowledge, you know how to do all these cool things. Why not use technology that can make you more efficient, that can allow you to be more productive? So I can see programming becoming more and more critical as part of the actuarial profession, especially for the younger actuaries who are working in the technical and the analytical spaces. But as you get older, and this is where we're going to maybe lean more towards the softer skill, and this is the soft skill of storytelling. I think it's critical that we learn how to build narratives, and we can communicate in a way that helps people understand what we're saying. Because something that's happened recently with the whole coronavirus and the pandemic and the lockdown was that these actuaries came in and they presented a graph and they explained everything. And for me, I was like, okay, cool, that sounds great. I'm exactly on their page. But I was reading some news articles that were comparing different models that the different people were making. And they were like, oh, and then the actuaries made this thing, which no one understood, or, oh, it was, the graphs were too complicated. And at first I was like, oh, well, you know, you guys just, you know, like, it wasn't that complicated. And then I thought, no, hold on. You know, we're so used to seeing this stuff. We have to be mindful of, you know, the other stakeholders that we deal with that maybe haven't had, you know, all this mathematical background that we've had. And that's where storytelling becomes a powerful thing. If you can guide people into understanding how you go from point A to point B, and, you know, what were the tricky things, but you do it in an engaging way, you're going to not lose people. They're not going to think, oh, the actor is just talking boring. They're actually going to be like, oh, wow, what happens next? So one of the things that I've been doing, like, it's, which is very non-actuarial, but like I say, I think it's good for the actuarial profession, has been reading up on myths, you know, the ancient Greek stories of, you know, all the crazy gods and monsters and those kind of things. And a psychologist called Carl Jung, you know, and how he explains it and how he also develops this myth narrative. So, like I said, it's a bit of a soft skill because it's not that mathematical. It's something that you might think, oh, you know, actually, I thought we were all about the, you know, the rational thinking and, you know, that type of side of the brain, where narrative is a little bit more on the creative side. But I think it is an important thing to have so that you can tell the story to aid in the communication of, you know, the work that you've produced.
I totally agree. Like, we need to emphasize on soft skills more. And actually, the society actuaries also develop a competency framework to promote the soft skills such as leadership or communication. So we all have to strive for to become a more well-rounded actuaries.
And then hopefully, like, you know, when we get portrayed in the media or in movies, it's not like, ooh, actuaries are those boring people that no one understands. But they can be like, ooh, actuaries, those are those cool people that know a lot of stuff, you know, and are fun to be around. So hopefully, yeah, and I think the profession has noted that, and that's why they are, yeah, pushing these things forward. But it's definitely something that, yes, you might do a course or two during the profession, but it's worth developing even further as well to, like you say, make sure that your career is future-proof. Because let's admit, AI and, you know, machine learning, yes, they might be able to do a lot of the technical stuff, and that's why you want the programming, because you want to be able to control the machines and control the AI to not replace you, but to work for you. But those things are going to be quite far away from the narrative and the storytelling and that true creative. I know they can imitate it, but to have that, yeah, that human touch, as to say, I think that's still going to be quite a far way away. And that is something that we can, if we develop, we can future-proof ourselves. So yeah, you know, if you are studying actuarial science, you don't want to just stay as a technician or a technical employee. You want to be able to work your way up where you are making more of the judgments and the decisions and, you know, reading the reports that people have written and drawing, you know, and looking at their conclusions and then using that to push the company forward rather than, like I said, just being the one who builds the reports, which can sometimes be quite tedious, whereas making the strategic moves, that's a lot more fun.
Totally agree. I believe that what we do is not just science, but it's also an art that requires a lot of judgment. Last but not least, do you have any advice for people who would like to pursue the actuarial profession?
Yeah, I mean, if you want to study actuarial science, I highly recommend it. I mean, it becomes a game changer. It really helps you. It gives you confidence. It makes you, like I say, I know this might come across a little bit arrogant, but it's almost like if you can study actuarial science, you can study anything. And that's lovely when you, let's say you're reaching my age and you finish with the exams, and let's say you get bored. You're like, you know what? Let me just read up on, let's say, you know, another subject that maybe, like, so for instance, I'm doing go-karting now. So mechanical engineering. This is something that is quite an intimidating subject, but I'm like, I study actuarial science, maths is maths. This is just another application of it. Let me give it a go. And yes, it's difficult, but I've got that confidence that I can push through it and develop it. So actuarial science has got a lot of long-term benefits. It really, really has long-term benefits. I mean, the pay is good. The job security is good. The demand for it is good. So a lot of long-term benefits. The short term is going to be hell. Like it's going to be miserable. You're going to have to make sacrifices. You're going to have to say goodbye to a lot of friends. You're going to have to cut down your time that you spend on social media. You're probably not going to be playing a lot of PlayStation games. You know, you really are going to be saying goodbye to other hobbies. So this is the thing that you have to decide. You can say, am I prepared to take the pain now and have an amazing future? And if you're like, I'm prepared to do that, then that's great, because that's actually, you've already got the actuarial mindset. if you're thinking that sounds horrible, you know, it's better to live for today. We don't know what tomorrow is going to happen. You know, I'd rather focus on the now and we'll worry about the later. Then actuarial science, you are going to get frustrated with it. But if you do choose the person, you do decide to do it, there will become times when you'll think that this stuff's impossible. You will get frustrated. You will think about quitting. But my advice to you is to just push, keep trying. If you fail an exam, it's fine. Write it again. I mean, as an actuary, you'll learn that the future is uncertain and there's 15 exams that you're going to write. So if you're thinking that you're going to have 100% pass rate on 15 exams, you know, that's almost an unrealistic mindset. You know, as an actor, you know that uncertainty is a thing. Even if you're super smart, you might not have a good night's rest the night before, or you might get stuck in traffic and be late at the exam. So don't give yourself additional pressure or this perfectionist mindset that I have to pass every exam the first time and I have to qualify as quickly as possible. You know what I mean? The thing's hard enough as it is. You don't have to overburden yourself with your own pressures. So yeah, accept failure. If you fail an exam, it doesn't mean that you can't be an actuary. It just means you have to write the exam again. If anything, it means your technical skills will be developed even better because you have spent more time looking at these things. So yeah, if you do decide to do it, understand that it's going to be tough. And once you're in it, keep pushing. And yeah, I think with that, hopefully, yeah, you'll be joining us on the side with and becoming a fellow actuary as well. So yeah, wish you best of luck if that is the choice that you decide to make.
Great advice, Michael. Thank you again so much for being here today. And you can follow Michael at MJ The Fellow Actuary for more actuarial content as well as other educational content about finance, investment, or Bitcoin and blockchain. I hope you all enjoyed today's video and learned more about the actuarial profession, especially the state of the actuarial profession in South Africa. So for more videos like this, don't forget to click the subscribe button and turn on your notification. So I will see you next week in another video. Have a happy and productive week ahead. Bye everyone.